गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग। वेल रिकॉल दैट यस्टरडे I have told about two algorithms to find out minimal spanning trees in a weighted graph, connected weighted graph. Hope you have understood. Or shall I take a example and explain you through example? So let us take one example and then explain these two algorithms. So these two algorithms Driscoll algorithm and Prim's algorithm. Okay, and Prim's algorithm. To find out minimal spanning tree in a connected weighted graph. So consider this graph. Just I'll take one example of a weighted graph, connected weighted graph. Let me draw. Okay. Suppose I'm having a suppose I am having a graph like this. Suppose I will take one more here, and also I will take one more here. Okay, and I am taking this. So the number of bodies is here. So it is B1, B2, B3, B4, B5, B6, B7, and B8. I have taken. Okay, fine. So this here I'll take the edges also. I'll take the name the edges, because so we shall arrange them in order of their weights also in Driscoll's algorithm. So the edges also let us take quickly. Say this is E1 and this is E2. Say this is I'm taking E3, this is E4, this is E5. This is E6. Here, this is E7. This is E8. This is E9. And this is E10, E11. And one more is left, I think. There are 12 edges I think I have taken. This is E12. Right. And we'll have the weights of the edges. Oh, this is a weighted graph. So I'll use this rate mark for this. So this weight is equal to, say, I mean, I'll take 2 weight of this edge, and this is this weight is five I'll take, and this weight I am taking is it is also five. And here I'll take this. I'll take here this is 3, and this one, say, I'll take 7, and this I'll take, say, again this E5. I think hope you'll able to make out here. E5 I'll take, say, this is 6. Okay, and E8, suppose I'll take this is 10. And this E7, suppose I will take again 2, And here I'll take say 3, so this I'll take 1, I'll take this is also 1, and then if 12 I am taking say this is 10, and this is say I'll take again 7, say. Okay, so I think I have assigned weights to all the edges that I can make out, right? Okay, so then I shall explain this Kruskal's algorithm first. So in Kruskal's algorithm here, Kruskal's algorithm. So here we have to arrange the weight of the, weight of the vertices in non-decreasing order. Okay, non-decreasing means it is either equal or increasing. So here, these weights that E10 and E11, they are having the minimum weight. Huh? So the weight of the edges are like this, that weight of E10, okay, so that you know that that is less than or equal to then. I am taking that weight of this. Huh? So these are all weights I will take. E10, then E11, this order. And then, then weight is for this. E1 is weight 2. Then E7 is weight 2. Okay. Then that minimum, that smallest weight is here is E6. That is weight 3. And then E6, then I'll take this E2 is 5 and E3 is also 5, and then one thing, E9 was there, no? E9 was 3. E7, E6, after E6 we can take that E9 is there, no? Right?
Excuse
E9
me,
is also 8.
Ma'am, you weighted E3 age twice.
E3 is
once you weighted it's 5 and once you get 7.
Okay. That is a mistake. Yeah? Twice. Okay, then we shall remove one of them. Okay. So let us take this piece. I'll take only 5. Okay. This one is okay. You ignore this one. Okay. 5. Okay. Ignore this. So yeah, good. So E9 is 3, then weight 5 is will be E2. Huh? E2 and E3. Okay, both are having same weight. And E3 after that, both were okay, E5. Okay. And after E5, we are having E4 is 7. Huh? And then E8 and E12. I hope I have E12 they have 10. Okay, fine. So there is total 12 edges were there. Whether I have taken care of all the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Whether I have missed some edge?
Ma'am, E5.
E5 I have written, E7 is also, E5 is there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, 12. Yeah, all 12 are there. I have written on. Okay. So this is how we learn. So in Kruskal's algorithm, first, we'll initialize. This is initialization of all these vertices. There are 8 vertices. So we can initialize that tree taking these isolated vertices. Okay. So you can take that V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, V7, and V8. You initialize. Okay. That spanning tree takes these isolated vertices. So first we shall select that edge with minimum weight, so that E10 is, I mean, this is having weight 1, so that joins V5 and V6. Okay, this is your E10 we are taking, E10. This is your E10 we are taking. This is weight 1. Okay. And then after that, we shall consider the next minimum weight is E, that is E11 here, and we'll check whether that is creating a cycle here or not. So E11 is not creating a cycle with this already chosen edge. So therefore, we shall take this E11. It is not creating any cycle with this. Okay. So the next minimum weight, that is E1. Okay, that is E1. And that is that is minimum weight. And that is joining V1 and V2. So it is also not creating cycle with already chosen, this edges. Okay, so therefore we can select this. Okay, therefore we can select this. So here it is, this is E1. This is E1. Okay, E1 we have taken. Fine. See, here in the beginning, this E10 and E11, they were same weight. So therefore, arbitrarily, randomly, we have chosen one of them. Huh? So this is E1, and this is E1. This is. And then, so then next minimum, weight H, that is E7. E7 is joining V2 and V4. V2. So that is, how come the 7 will come, 5 is there, no? Here some ordering is, okay. Achha. E7 will not appear here. Yeah. Okay, E7 will not appear here. E2 and E3, no? E9. Oh, what is the weight of this?
Okay.
This not, oh, okay. Will is here. Yeah. 2. Okay, fine. E7 was 2. Yeah. E7 is, weight is 2, yeah. Okay, ordering is all right, it is correct. So E7 is joining this V7 and V8. Okay, V7 and V8, and it is also not creating any cycle with already chosen edges. So we can select this E7, this is E7, okay. And then next one is minimum weight is E6. E6 is which one? Okay. Here 4, 12, okay, and then yeah. E6 is joining that V1 and V8. Okay, V1 and V8. V1 and V8. Let us see this V1 and V8 edge, if we include, it is not creating any cycle with this existing edges. So this is what we can take this E6 also, we can select. Then next one is E9. So E9, that is joining which vortices? That which one I have taken, that is V6 and V7. V6 and V7. Okay, so this V6 and V7, V6 and V7, if we join, okay, if we join V6 and V7, it is also not creating any cycle. So here we can take this H, E9 we can select. Okay, so the next one is E2. E2 and E3, see, suppose I would have taken this one as E3, just I want to tell you, this is E2, I would have taken. So whether I can take E3 and E2, they are having same weight, of course. So E3 is, suppose, next minimum weight. So E3 is joining V2 and V8, okay. E3 is joining this V2 and V8, okay. So therefore, we cannot select E3 here. Okay, just I was wanted to explain this step. Okay, so if we choose this E3, that is, E3 and vortices are V2 and V8. So we cannot take this edge, okay, B2 and B8. It is creating a cycle with this already chosen edges. So therefore, we cannot take this E3 here in this stage. Okay, E3 cannot take, okay. And now E2 we can take B2 to B3 it is joining, and B2 to B3 it is joining, and it is not creating any cycle. Okay, one thing just I was wanted to tell you that, when we are, we'll stop, okay, when we'll stop. So number of edges actually. So each time we'll check that whether we have already, selected n minus 1 number of edges or not. Okay, so here in this step, there are total 8 vortices and we have already chosen 7 edges. So therefore, we'll stop actually. This is what our stopping criteria. Okay. This is what our stopping criteria. Well, this is what our stopping criteria. All right. And you'll get this tree. Of course, it has come to a path. I could have taken some other weights. Okay. So in Kruskal's algorithm, you get this output. Okay. Fine. So now the Prim's algorithm. So Prim's algorithm, you have to, start with minimum weight. Say that is both, again, E10 and E11 are there. So we'll select one of them, okay, any one of them. So let us take, suppose I'll take E11, okay, that is minimum weight. So E11 means it is joining this vortices B4 and B5. So here we have to include this edge, that is B4, B5. We'll start with B4, B5, and this B5, and this is what your, B5, and this is the edge I'm taking here. Okay, so by the way, what is the weight of, here you can also count this weight of this minimal. So you take this sum of weights of all the edges here. Okay, that will be the minimum. That is the minimum weight spanning tree here in this graph. Okay, that weight also you can find out. Okay, understand? Weight means the sum of weights of all the edges. Okay, that I have already told. So in Prim's algorithm, that V1 and V5 we have. V4 and V5. That is. E11 is the edge we are selecting. So the next in Prim's algorithm is that we have to select and we shall see. So this ordering we will not consider in Prim's algorithm. Okay, that is maybe for our reference. So what we shall do is that we shall consider a minimum weight edge that has one end vortex in already this chosen, graph, or you can say that chosen the T and another vortex will be outside T. Okay, so this T we are actually, growing like this. So this T in T we have already included this edge E11. So now we shall look at that, we shall consider those edges, which have one end vortex in this already chosen portion and another end vortex will be outside that. Okay. And among all such edges, we shall select the one with minimum weight. Okay. So just you look at here. Let me do my rough work here this is what we have already chosen this T. So now we shall look at this all the edges through B4 and B5 kind of thing. Okay. So what is this B4? Through B4 only, you are having only one edge like this. One end vortex will be, this is our already chosen part. Okay. This is already that already chosen. And one vortex should be inside this, another vortex should be outside that. So here B4 through B4, only one edge is there, and that is E4, and it is joining B4 to B2. And through B5, we are having two edges. Okay, we are having two edges. You see, through B5, one is this E10 and E8. Okay, E10 and E8. What happened? Okay, so this is E10, is this is joining B6 and here joining B8. Okay, so among this, B6, what about their weights? E4 is having weight, it's 7. This is the weight of this, E4. And this B5 to B6, this weight is 1. And here this weight is 10. Okay, so there are three such edges possible which have one end vortex in already chosen portion and another end vortex is outside that. So among these three, we'll select one that has minimum weight. Okay, so here this edge B5 to B6, that has minimum weight. Okay, so therefore we shall include this B5 to B6, this edge, okay, E10. So this same process will be repeating. Okay, so now we are already having this chosen one is this. Okay, this edges. And the next, which edge you are going to select? We look at all these. So we have extended our, this T is this. We have included this. We have included this part. Okay, so now these edges are still there. This, E4 and here this edge. This was E8. Okay, these edges are there. So now again we shall include that all these, repeat this from through this B6. One end vortex is B6 and another end vortex will be outside this. So through B6 you are having this, another one that here E9 is there, this edge, E9 is joining this vortex B7. And the other one is here that it is joining this B3, you see, this is 12, edge 12. And now we look at the weights of all these edges. So weight of this E9 is, it is 3. Okay, weight of E9 is here 3, weight is 3. E12 is that is 10, So among all such possible edges, the one having minimum weight is this E9. So therefore, B6 to B7 will join. B6 to B7. You are going to include. So you'll be repeating this process till you select N minus 1 edges. Till you select this N minus 1 number of edges, one will be repeating this process. This is what Prim's algorithm. Complete this example yourself. Hope you'll be able to do it. So the main difference between these two algorithms, Kruskal algorithm, is that it checks for a cycle. Formation of cycle, whether it forms a cycle or not. A cyclic condition it is checking, this Kruskal algorithm. This Prim's algorithm, actually it is checking the connectivity at each step. Each step it is just continuing with a connected graph only. The connectivity is maintained. So this is the main difference between these two algorithms, Kruskal's and Prim's algorithm. So at each step in Prim's algorithm, that updated T we are getting is a connected graph. That is always a connected one. Connected tree. You are getting a tree actually. That is a connected one. However, in Kruskal's algorithm, that the graph we get, that subgraph we are constructing the T actually, in an intermediate step, that may be a disconnected one, but finally you get connected. So this is what the main difference between these two algorithms. Hope you will be able to complete this algorithm, this example. Okay, that's all, student. You understand? Or any query, tell me. Tell me, any query if you have. So whether it is all right to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this, I mean, finding spanning trees or minimal spanning trees, this is very important concept. Okay. So the next, I'll introduce another concept is this. So that just you recall that I had asked you that optoisomorphism, how many simple graphs you can have on say three vertices. Just you recall that question. Okay. Just you recall this, I mean, here you just recall that number of, non-isomorphic simple graphs. Number of non-isomorphic graphs. Okay, number of non-isomorphic simple graphs. Suppose I'll consider simple graphs on say three vertices, say for example I'll consider, and in general I was so how many were there on three vertices, you know that number of non-isomorphic simple graphs means we may consider that first no edge, okay, only one edge, okay, according to edges I'm just moving, okay, and that is, this is simple graph, so two edges, well, and that you get that the three edges, this is just simple one, and on three edges you are getting, so only four you are getting, okay, so that total number of non-isomorphic simple graphs on three vertices, these are the only four. Your answer is four in number. That's what you'll get. And the same question, if we ask on four vertices, okay, that the number of graphs you're getting, number of non-isomorphic graphs, number of non-isomorphic graphs, how many were there? You remember? On four vertices and number of non-isomorphic simple graphs. Okay, we are looking into the simple graphs. How many were there? You remember that total 11 were there, right? Number of non-isomorphic simple graphs on four vertices. Just you recall. Is it all right? This was one, and then next you will get this. With two edges, you could have got this one. You could have got this way. This is one more edge, right? So it goes on like this. Total 11 you are getting. So this same question actually, that optoisomorphism, number of total number of here if I modify this question, what will be this, let us say total number of I'll say that total number of total number of non-isomorphic trees on four vertices. Total number of non-isomorphic trees on four vertices. Tell me what will be your answer. Total number of non-isomorphic trees on four vertices. What will be your answer? Tell quickly. Total number of non-isomorphic trees on four vertices. How many will be there? Who can answer? Tell. This is one. How many you are going to get?
Ma'am, this is a U shape.
There's a path. Okay. That is path. So how many you are getting? These two only?
Yes, ma'am.
Huh? Yes. Okay. So here your answer will be two, right? Your answer will be two, right? So you are looking into that he is on four body cells. Means he have to take these three edges and acyclic. Huh? That three edges and connected or connected or acyclic, any one of these. Okay. So that is why you get only these two, right? Okay. So in general, if we ask this question, okay, for any N body cells, that how many non-isomorphic trees on N body cells will be there? Okay. So then what will be your answer? So total number of non-isomorphic trees on N body cells. So the same question I'll ask for any arbitrary number. Total number of non-isomorphic trees on N body cells. N is say any number that greater than or equal to 2. Okay, for any arbitrary N. So what will be its answer? What will be answer of this? Right.
N minus 2.
Huh?
N minus 2.
N minus 2 only? N minus 2? Huh?
Maybe means like if we draw N points and connect them in a straight line. Then taking each point from the end and branching to the other side, there are more possibilities.
Okay, you are saying only n minus 2. Okay, n is equal to say, here you have
called. No, ma'am, there are more possibilities.
Yeah, right. More possibilities.
It's like this, ma'am. For n, suppose let's say for n vertices, we have some certain number of non-isomorphic trees. Then for the next vertex, I think we'll have 2 times n, right? Or
2 times. See, for example, just you take this n equal to 5. This case. Okay, the simplest one is your P5 here. Path. Okay, this is a spanning tree. So the next, you could have got that, some other possibilities kind of thing. Okay, next, simplest one is your star graph. Okay. This is that K14, this star one, next simplest one. Okay, and then I could have got like this. Okay, this is one tree that I'll get. What about any other one? Oh, I have taken one more. Okay, yeah. Five vertices I have taken. So here you are getting any other, only these two. This is trivial one, only five vertices. So any other non-isomorphic thing? Okay. I think in this case, are you getting any other?
Ma'am, covered on all outer points. A pentagon covered in all outer points.
This is P5 only. This is already taken, P5. And this is the star one. So here actually you can go with your, systematically with the degree of vortices. Degree of vortices. So in this case I am taking there is a degree 4 vortex. Maximum degree of a vortex will be 4. Degree 4 vortex will get this one. This is only one possibility. Suppose you are having a degree 3 vortex. You will take a degree 3 vortex means one vortex is adjacent to three other vortices, and other vortex you take, that will be adjacent to any one of them. This would have been adjacent to either this or any one of them. But in that case, you are getting that graph, that tree to be isomorphic. If you would have been, adjacent with this one, the middle one, then these two are isomorphic, right? These two trees, they are isomorphic. They are isomorphic trees. Okay. So whenever you are having a degree 3 vortex, you are getting both are, I mean, both are isomorphic here. The only one possibility. Then maximum degree. Okay, maximum degree was here 3. Maximum degree is 2. Maximum degree is 2 means here that you get a vortex of degree 2. You get a vortex of degree 2. And I mean, you just proceed like this. You get a degree 2 vortex. Okay, and a maximum degree is 2, so therefore this won't be adjacent to any other vortex. Maximum degree, the capital delta T we are taking of this tree. Here it is equal to 2. The maximum degree is capital delta. Okay, then maximum degree is 2 means here this vortex cannot be adjacent to any other vortex. So, but it is a connected graph. I mean, we are constructing a tree. So only possibility is that the next vortex will be adjacent to either this side or the other side. So here you are going to get a path only. You are going to get a path only. So you don't have any other possibility for this. Okay, you don't have any other possibilities. Then. Well, so I mean, whatever results you told here, that total number of trees on 5 vortices. Here, of course, you are getting this formula n minus 2, but in general, it is not true. So incidentally, just I mean, this is a coincidence kind of thing. Here, your answer is 3 actually. When n equal to 5, this number is equal to 3. You are getting only 3. Okay, but you are not going to get that when you consider that number of vortices at n, higher values of n if you consider. So, I mean, similarly, you tell me that when n is equal to 6, how many non-isomorphic trees you will get? First one is this, okay, the trivial one, I'll just tell you that 6 vortices means here you are getting P6. And then next trivial one is here, this star graph. Okay, one vortex that it is adjacent to that K15. Okay, complete bipartite graph with one vortex in one part and 5 vortices on the other part. That star graph. Then next you could have got that maximum degree is 4. Okay, there is a vortex of, I mean, there is a vortex. So here also, vortex of degree 4. Okay, so here you get this to be, I mean, this graph only, no other possibility. So here maximum degree is equal to say 3. Maximum degree is equal to 3. So there are 2 more vortices, and you may have that, I mean, one vortex is adjacent to here, the other vortex is adjacent to here. Okay. And here maximum degree is equal to 3 means I could have taken this way. So now you look at that these two are, I mean, these two trees, they have maximum degree 3, but they are not isomorphic. Okay. In fact, they have the same degree sequence. They have the same degree sequence, but they are not isomorphic. That you can find out that these two trees, they are not isomorphic, right? Maximum degree is equal to 3. Okay. See, already you have got that here 5 non-isomorphic trees I have got so far. So that n minus 2 formula will not work here, right? N minus 2 formula will not work. Did you get the point? Number
yes,
of
ma'am.
Okay, that yes, n ma'am. Minus 2 formula that is not working here. So when we take the value of n is bigger, so this formula is not going to hold true, right? So in general, actually, this answer is not known. Okay, the answer is not known. I mean, if I take this total number of non-isomorphic trees on n vortices, okay, so suppose this value is equal to say Tn. Let me write this Tn is this value, okay? So here we are getting that value of T5 is equal to 3, T5 is equal to 3, this number, okay. So, in general, this value of Tn is not known so far. I mean, so far it is unknown. So, this in general, this Tn value this n actually for any n greater than or equal to 2. This is, so far it is open, it is not known. I mean, it is in general not known. Okay. So it is unknown, this value of Tn. Well, so why only that number of trees on n vertices? If we consider that number of non-isomorphic graphs on n vertices, number of non-isomorphic, I mean simple graphs on n vertices. Okay, not only in case of trees, for graphs also, simple graphs, number of non-isomorphic, up to isomorphism, then number of simple graphs on n vertices. There is no answer of that also. That is also not known. Up to small values, one can write a computer program and get somehow. But when n is very big, this value is still undetermined. This is not yet known. Okay. But I'll tell you one thing that here. So let me, come back to that question again, that on three vertices I was looking. If we consider a labeled graph, if we name the vertices, if we name the vertices, see here, I am not naming these vertices. So just I am looking at, this graph or this tree on three vertices. I am not naming these vertices, okay? Or not a labeled graph. And the other one, suppose I am maybe naming these vertices as X, Y, Z, okay? So this is called unlabeled graph, and this is labeled graph. Okay, this is called labeled graph, and this is unlabeled graph. Labeled or names, if we assign names to vertices, we'll say this is a labeled graph, and if we'll not assign names to the vertices, that is unlabeled graph. Okay, so in case of this labeled graph, another thing, see, whenever I am asking that number of trees on n vertices, is it not the same as if I consider the complete graph on n vertices? Is it not the same thing that if I take the complete graph on n vertices? So this is exactly same as that Tn is the number of trees on n vertices. Tn is, in fact, it is same as the number of, this is also same as number of spanning trees, number of spanning trees of this Kn. Both are same question, right? Do you agree with this? That Tn is the number of, number of non-isomorphic, okay? Now, whenever we count something, we count up to isomorphism, So this non-isomorphic is always there. Whenever we count non-isomorphic objects. So there is no point in counting isomorphic things. How many times will we count it? Isomorphic objects, you can count so many times. Okay. So whenever we count something, we count non-isomorphic objects only. So this number of non-isomorphic trees on n vertices, that is same as number of non-isomorphic spanning trees of Kn. Whether both are same? Tell me, whether both these questions are same, that number of non-isomorphic, so whether both are same, that number of non-isomorphic trees on n vertices, whether that is same as number of non-isomorphic, number of non-isomorphic spanning trees of Kn. So think and tell me, whether these two questions are same. Are you listening to me, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So whether these two questions are same? That number of non-isomorphic trees on n vertices. This Tn I had taken. Just let me repeat. This number of non-isomorphic trees on n vertices. This is equal to number of non-isomorphic trees of Kn. Do you agree this? These two statements? Both are equal. These two are equal. It is clear. First you get convinced.
Yes, whether,
okay. So whether these two are same? So number of non-isomorphic trees on n vertices. Okay. If a tree on n vertices. Okay, a tree on n vertices. That will be a spanning tree of Kn, right? What is a spanning tree? Spanning tree means that is a subgraph which is a tree and that covers all the vertices. And that covers all the vertices. That is what it is, I mean, a tree on n vertices is doing here. Complete graph means all pairs of vertices are adjacent. Okay, all pair of vertices are adjacent. So therefore, you get these two statements are equal. Whether you get? Okay, so these two statements are equal. Fine. So then next, I was coming to this labeled graph and unlabeled graph. So here, say, I'll consider this K3 and this is labeled. This is labeled K3, this is unlabeled. Both are K3. Here I have just put the name. Okay. So here labeled K3, this one, and here unlabeled. Unlabeled K3. Both are K3. Here this is also K3, this is also K3. I am considering. Okay. And I'll just, this same question will ask here that the number of, I mean, up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of unlabeled K3. Okay. And here, your answer, you know that, I mean, I'll ask up to isomorphism. Up to isomorphism means we consider that non-isomorphic only. Up to isomorphism, number of spanning tree of unlabeled K3. Unlabeled K3. What is your answer? You know this. Up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of unlabeled K3. So, what is your answer? Up to isomorphism.
P3. Means one means, unit only.
Yeah, only one, right? Okay. Number, we are counting number. So your answer is one, right? Fine.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, very good. Okay. But in case of labeled graph, this situation will be, that situation will be treated differently. Okay, in case of labeled graph, I mean, here you get that all these spanning, trees for this unlabeled K3, they look like this only, this P3 only, right? All are looking like this. But when we assign names to this vertices, then here this one, say this is X, this is Y, this is J, and the other one I am taking here is like this, say, this is X, this is Z, and this is Y. Okay. So in case of labeled or named, these vertices are named, these two will be treated as different. These two will be treated as different spanning tree, different spanning trees of K3. I mean, when we assign label, why they are different when we assign names to the vertices? See, in this tree,
so it is similar to the distinct and identical objects that we
Yeah. So here, this in this T1, say suppose, I mean, in T1, suppose there are three persons. Yes. Suppose three persons are there. Three people are there. So here, this X and Y, they are sitting next to each other. Okay. So they are sitting next to each other. And in T2, X and Y, they are not sitting that, I mean, X and Y, they are not sitting next to each other. Okay, that labeled boxes or unlabeled boxes kind of thing. Okay. So here, X and Y, they are not neighbor of each other. Okay, they are not sitting near to each other. Here, X and Y, they are sitting near to each other. Okay, so therefore, these two will be treated as two different spanning trees of this labeled K3, of this labeled K3. Okay, so how many these labeled, I mean, the spanning trees of labeled K3 will get? Number of spanning trees, or here this is up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of unlabeled K3. So up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of labeled K3, what will be your answer? Up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of labeled K3. Labeled K3. What will be your answer here?
3.
You will get 3, right? One more. Here we can proceed in this way also. You will get 3 only here. This X and here Y, Z is, this is the other one, the third one. Okay. So your answer is 3. You are getting 3. Fine. So, although we are not having any answer for this value of Tn, okay, we don't have the answer for this value of Tn. That of what was this Tn actually? That up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of unlabeled Kn. So we don't have no answer for this. We don't have any answer. So far, it is, I mean, unknown that number of up to isomorphism, I'll write up to, no formula is there for this up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of unlabeled Kn, unlabeled Kn, complete n is greater than or equal to 2. So this one answer is not known. Okay, so first answer is not known. This is not known. But if we ask this question for labeled Kn, the answer is known. Okay, if we ask this question for labeled Kn, then answer is known. There is a formula for that. The formula is there. Okay. Formula is there for this labeled one. Okay. So up to isomorphism, number of spanning trees of labeled Kn. This formula is there. This formula is known. And this formula was given by Kelle while counting the number of isomers of saturated hydrocarbon. That Kelle has given this formula that long, long back. So this, however, the answer is known for, okay, that however, the answer is known for labeled Kn. Labeled Kn. And this is exactly the result given by Kelle. So just I'll write that as a theorem. Okay, so proof is also there. Several proofs are there. And of course, I am not giving the proof. and this was due to Kele. Kele, 1889. This formula was given by Kele in 1889 while counting isomers of saturated hydrocarbons. This formula. So this formula is that there are n to the power n minus 2 labeled, I mean that, okay, that total number of up to isomorphism, total number of spanning trees of labeled Kn, okay, I'll write down the statement like this, up to isomorphism, up to isomorphism, total number of spanning trees of labeled Kn is n to the power n minus 2. Okay. N to the power n minus 2, n is greater than or equal to 2. So this formula is n to the power n minus 2. And this statement is also equivalent to, I mean, I have already told you, this statement will also be equivalent to up to isomorphism. There are n to the power n minus 2 labeled trees. Okay. N to the power n minus 2 label trees. Okay, this statement is, I mean, this statement is equivalent to, I mean, equivalent, this statement equivalent to, equivalently, you can also say that there are n to the power n minus 2 labeled trees on n vertices. This is up to isomorphism. Trees on n vertices. Whenever we are counting something, that always we are looking at non-isomorphism. So we say that up to isomorphism. This was. If you like, you can. Okay. I've already told you. Fine. Okay, so this proof I am not giving. There are several proofs available. Okay, usually the one, I mean, the technique is a proof or code technique and all. Proof given by proof or. If you are interested, you can read this one. That proof or code. Proof or code. Or this, I mean, the proof given by proof or. So this is, that a better way to prove or easy way to see this proof. Okay, because of lack of this time, I'm not covering. If I go for this proof, then it will take one more hour kind of thing. Okay, so I don't want to spare this. Okay, and if you are interested, you can go through. And if you want to learn from me, then you can ask me. I can take extra class also for you and explain this. It is very interesting. The proof is a very nice and very interesting one. Okay, so because of lack of time, I'm not giving that. Fine. So whenever we label certain things, this answer is no. So this is about isomorphic. I mean, no, number of non-isomorphic spanning trees of labeled Kn. Okay, for a labeled complete graph, one can find the total number of spanning trees up to isomorphism. The total number of spanning trees one can find out. This formula is there. But what about for any other general graph? Whether this answer is known. Instead of this complete graph, labeled complete graph, if I consider any labeled graph. Okay, so whether the answer is known for any labeled graph, whether one can count the total number of spanning trees up to isomorphism, I mean the total number of spanning trees in a labeled graph other than this complete one. So what will be the answer and how to do that? Okay, so later on people have also developed, this result they have got a way to compute. People have obtained a method to compute the total number of spanning trees in a labeled graph. Okay, labeled graph that may be complete, may be incomplete. Means people have extended these to any arbitrary graph that may be complete, may not be complete. Okay, so just I'll give again statement for that. That is also another interesting result. Okay, and just I'll give you this statement, and in the statement itself we will find out the answer, how to compute that total number of spanning trees in a labeled graph that need not be complete one. Okay, so this theorem is also very well known theorem, and it gives method to compute actually. So that I'll write down as a result again. This is the theorem, and this is the matrix. This theorem is a name. This is matrix tree theorem. Matrix tree theorem, because it involves some matrices to answer this question. That's what I have asked. It involves some matrices to answer this question. Okay, and to prove this theorem, people have used so many results on linear algebra. Okay, linear algebra, matrix theory, all those results have been used to prove this theorem, this matrix tree theorem. So therefore, this linear algebra is, very useful in everywhere, in almost all branches of science and engineering, or any kind of mathematics you come across. This linear algebra is very, very basic course. So using linear algebra concept only, this theorem has been proved. I'll not tell the proof part again, that is a bit lengthy one, it will take long time. Okay, so just I'll tell you the statement. So here we are considering that a labeled graph G. Okay, so let G be a loop free. It has no loop. Parallel edges may be allowed. Let G be a loop free. Labeled and connected. Labeled one. Okay. G be a loop free labeled connected one. Connected graph. Labeled. Connected graph on n vertices. Okay, on n vertices. See, n is greater than or equal to 2. And you would know already the adjacency matrix of the graph, right? You know the adjacency matrix of the graph. So here, this theorem uses that adjacency matrix of the graph. Let A be the adjacency matrix. A be the adjacency matrix of the graph G. And graph on n vertices. So for your convenience, I can take the vertices B. So let us name the vertices x1, x2, to xn. So A be the adjacency matrix of G, and D be a diagonal matrix. I'll take this diagonal matrix. This is also n by n matrix. That is degree diagonal matrix. So diagonal matrix with diagonal entries be this diagonal matrix with diagonal entries. I think you understand if I use this notation that here degree of x1, degree of x2, this is diagonal matrix with degree, diagonal entries are degree of the vertices. Okay, this is diagonal matrix with diagonal entries be the degree of the vertices of the graph. Okay, so this is degree diagonal matrix of the graph G. Okay, then you understand this. Okay, so we define some more thing. Some more matrices. So that is Dn is this diagonal matrix. Okay, this diagonal matrix with entries this, and this is what the D I have defined. Okay, then next I will take that these matrices I am defining. Q I am taking this D minus A. Understand? This is degree diagonal matrix D and this is adjacency matrix A. Okay, this is Q. And another one is this, and Q star be obtained from Q, that Q star will get from Q by deleting any one of this, say ith row and jth column, any row or any column. So Q star be obtained from Q by deleting say rth row, obtained from Q by deleting rth row and sth column. Okay, for any r and s, for any r and s that Q star we are getting from Q by deleting one row and one column, just I have named those row as say rth row and that column is sth column. So all these matrices are involved here. Once we get these matrices, then now we'll conclude that the number of spanning trees, in this labeled graph G is okay. So now that then the here everything is up to isomorphism. Number of spanning tree, everything is here up to isomorphism that I have already told you. Isomorphism of this labeled graph, G is labeled graph, actually it comes in this form, the determinant form, minus 1 whole to the power R plus S. R is rth row, sth column we have removed. Multiplied by determinant of this matrix Q star. This is what your answer. Okay. So this matrix tree theorem, it gives the total number of spanning trees in a labeled graph G. G is a loop-free graph. Okay, loop-free labeled graph. Well, so let us take one example to, explain this theorem. Okay, matrix tree theorem. I'll consider this one, this example. I'll take this graph G is this labeled graph. This labeled graph is this here. That V1 to say the vertices names I have given here like this. V1, V2, V3, and here V4. Okay. Four vertices I have taken. This labeled graph, this is what my graph G, labeled graph G. So we'll find the total number of spanning trees of G using this matrix tree theorem. So how many spanning trees this graph G will be? Ruby. Okay, so for that we have to take this, adjacency matrix of this graph. So adjacency matrix means you know that that you have to index the rows and columns. Okay, so B1, B2, B3, B4. So tell me this entry. This is 0. Okay. And V1 to V2, they are adjacent. Tell me this entry. Please tell what I will get this. V1 to V3. Whether I will get like this. Check. V2. V2 is adjacent to this with this 0. And then V2 is adjacent to V3. Yes. And V4, no. Okay, V3 is adjacent to V1, yes. V3 is V2, yes. This is 0. And this V3, V4, yes. Okay, this is V4. Okay, V4 is adjacent to V1, yes. V4 is adjacent to V2, no. It is V3 and this is 0. This is what adjacency matrix. And this diagonal matrix, degree diagonal matrix, again we shall index, we should follow the same order of indexing, the vertex order you should not interchange, otherwise you will not get the answer. So V1 to V1, degree of this vertex is 3, right? All other, this is diagonal matrix. So V2 is 2, right? V3 is degree is 3, V4 degree is 2. So here you get this entry is 2. Understand? You get this one is 2. This entry is 2. So A and B we shall get like this. Fine. And now we have to find out the Q. Q is your matrix that we are getting D minus A. Okay. D minus A is, this is also, this has a name, this is also called Laplacian matrix of the graph G. This is also very important matrix actually. This is Laplacian, this Q is called Laplacian matrix. Laplacian matrix of G actually. This is D minus A, Laplacian matrix. This is a name and this is very important matrix. Okay. It has some other, significance in graph theory. This Laplacian matrix has so many other, it bears so many properties actually of a graph. It gives so many properties, okay. So what is this D minus A, this matrix? D minus A is, here you get 3, and here minus 1, right? And here you get minus 1, this is 2, that is, this is minus 1 and 0. And minus 1, 3, minus 1. Minus 1, 0, minus 1 and 2. Right? This is a D minus A. Okay. So then Q star. Now I'll just ask you to get the answer. So you compute yourself. That Q star I have told you that you will obtain from Q by removing any row or any column. Say Rth row and Sth column. But which row number and column number? Row number and column number you should note down. And finally your answer, number of spanning trees will be -1 to the power that row number plus column number which you have deleted. Multiplied with this determinant of Q star. Okay, so all of you compute and tell me the answer. What answer you are getting? That is up to you, that how you will select this Q star. Which row, which column you are going to delay? That is up to you. Any row, any column you can delay. And tell me your answer now. The total number of spanning trees you tell me.
Is it 8?
Yes, correct. Total number of Any other student? Fanning?
Ma'am, I had a doubt.
Tell me. Fanning, please.
In the theorem, you said that G should be loop-free labeled connected graph, no?
Yeah.
But this graph is a loop, right?
Where is loop? Loop means
V1, V2, V3.
Achha, you are still... Loop means not cycle. Not cycle in the graph.
Loop means this one.
No.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so these are called loops. That I have told you, such type of edges are called loops in a graph.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Tell me.
Ma'am, we count the rows and the column numbers from 0 or from 1.
Row number means 5. 0 or 1.
Doesn't make a difference, right? It's S plus R.
Yeah, R plus
R. Okay. Yes.
Okay, here Sth column and this R and S, of course, they will be from 1 to n. Their range will be 1 to n. Okay. R and S, they lie that any row number, any column number from 1 to n. Okay.
Yes, sir.
All of you are getting 8. Your answer, you are getting 8. You try others
yes,
also.
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yes.
Any row, any column, I mean, that is up to you. You delete that. Suppose here I'll obtain that Q star by removing this first row and first column, say. Okay. So Q star I may obtain like this. First row and first column, suppose. I'll delete first row and first column. So I'll get the matrix Q star is -1, -3, -1. And 0, minus 1, and here 3. Okay, I have removed first column and first row and first column. Removed first row and first column. So I'll get this one. And now I will get this determinant of Q star. Actually, you are getting 8 actually. So your answer is 8 actually. So here, -1^(1+1)) × determinant of Q star. Okay, so you can remove any row or any column, that is up to you. Okay, so this theorem has been proved using linear algebra technique. Okay, and this is very important theorem also. Okay, and one thing I'll tell you, that this is most general theorem. That the one we have seen earlier due to Kelly, that number of spanning trees in complete graph. So whether you can prove this theorem of Kelly using this matrix tree theorem? Using matrix tree theorem, can you prove that theorem of Kelly? This is easy one. Just I'll tell you that, you try this. Using matrix tree theorem, prove Kelly's. Kelly's, that is also called Kelly's formula. So this is also called Kelly's formula. This one is called Kelly's formula also. Kelly gives this formula. So using matrix tree theorem, you can prove also Kelly's formula. Hope you'll able to do this, because you have to just consider the graph G as the complete graph. Here in matrix tree theorem, we have to take the graph to be complete graph. And you know the adjacency matrix of a complete graph. You know this degree diagonal matrix D of a complete graph. All diagonal entries will be equal to n minus 1. Okay, so now you can form this matrix Q, right? And you know this adjacency matrix, except the diagonal entries, all other entries are equal to 1. All diagonal entries, they are 0, and other entries are all 1. For complete graph, that adjacency matrix will get like this. So that matrix Q easily you can form. Okay, and then Q star, you will delete one row, one column. And then you apply this row operations, okay, elementary row operations, and find out determinant of that matrix. And prove this Kelly's formula. Okay, this is a good exercise. That I leave this as an exercise. So prove Cayley's theorem, applying this matrix tree theorem. Okay, you try this exercise yourself. Applying matrix tree theorem, prove Cayley's formula or Cayley's theorem. This is an exercise for you. Fine. So these are some, interesting results here. And so then next, I will tell you about this last thing on this. Three things that I'll not take much time, and I'll tell you about rooted trees finally. So you should know, about this, you should have idea about rooted trees. What is the meaning of rooted trees? Okay, rooted trees, that students do come across in, say, data structure or any in computer science and all, and in several kind of these algorithms and all nowadays. This is also very much useful actually in machine learning and all these rooted trees. Okay, that people do come across. So rooted trees is very simple one. Okay, I'll just take another 10 minutes and explain this what it is. Okay, this rooted trees is very easy one. So what do you mean by a rooted tree? Okay, earlier we have seen a tree only. Okay, we have seen a tree. So what is the meaning of a rooted tree? So just you consider one example of a, say, tree here. I'll take one example of a tree, say, one example of a tree. Say, just arbitrarily I have taken a tree. Okay, I have taken a tree. So this is a tree, and rooted tree means rooted tree is a tree. That is a tree. First of all, it is a tree in which one vertex is specified or distinguished as root vertex. Just I'll fix any vertex from given any tree. I'll just distinguish one vertex as the root vertex. I'll say just specify or distinguish these vertices. I'll say this vertex is root vertex. I'll say that any vertex you can select from a tree, actually given any tree, any vertex you can select as your root vertex, any arbitrary vertex you can select it. Okay, if you want to select this as also your root vertex, yes, you are allowed. So rooted tree means that is a tree in which a vertex is distinguished as the root vertex. Okay, so rooted tree is nothing but a tree in which a vertex is distinguished as a root vertex. A vertex is specified as the root vertex. It is a root vertex. This is called rooted tree, actually. Any vertex. So given any tree on n vertices, we can construct or have n number of rooted trees. Any of the n vertices, any one of these n vertices, you can take as the root vertex. You can fix as the root vertex. That is called a rooted tree. Well, actually in a rooted tree, there are certain, names of other vertices. Once you fix a vertex as the root vertex, this is your root vertex, then there are names for other vertices actually. So we are naming the vertices kind of thing, or ordering the vertices kind of thing. So one vertex we shall fix as root vertex. Okay, then you know that in a tree If I consider any vortex, okay, suppose it extends, okay, this tree I am considering here, okay, I am considering this, and this can extend actually that to any extent. Suppose I am taking this one. So any vortex you consider, okay, any vortex you consider here, any vortex you consider, say your root vortex is V here. Then any other vortex, say X, I'll take here X, any vortex, you know that there is a unique path, because this is a tree. There is a unique path from vortex X to the root vortex, right? There is a unique path only because it is a tree. So from X to any vortex, wherever you, I mean, consider this vortex. So from X to vortex B, you will have unique path. So let, I mean, this PX be the unique path, from X to root vortex, from vortex X to vortex B. That is the root vortex. This is the root vortex. To this root vortex. Okay. So that means we are considering this path, I mean, or that you can see here, that unique path we are having is this one, okay, this is the unique path we are having. Well, so then this, I mean, length of this path, okay, length of this path is also called the depth or level of this vortex. Okay, first of all, this length of this vortex, this path, we get Px. This is called, length of this path is called the depth or level of this vortex. It is called the depth or level of this vortex X. Okay, so for every vortex, therefore you can find out its depth or level of this vortex. Okay, so this is how actually that we are measuring and fixing a vortex, the root vortex, and how far the other vortices are there from the root vortex. Okay, that is called the level or depth of that vortex. Well, so on this path, that this is what the path Px, so the neighbor of this vortex X on this path, the neighbor of this vortex X on this path, okay, say here you are getting this vortex is a Y, okay, this vortex we are getting, say, name is a Y, so X will have a unique neighbor, right? X is have a unique neighbor lying on this path. X has a unique neighbor on this path. So this unique neighbor of X on this path, that is called the parent. This is called the parent of this vortex X. Okay. So the unique neighbor, here we get this, first definition. The second one is that the unique neighbor of X on this path Px is called the parent of X. The unique neighbor of X on Px, okay, is called the parent of this path X. So Y is parent of X in this example. And this Y might be having other neighbors on this rooted tree. Okay, on this rooted tree T. So the other neighbors of, here the unique neighbor of X on this Px is called parent. The other neighbors of X on this tree T are called children. Okay, so the other neighbors of X on this T. The other neighbors are here. Say here, other neighbors are, you are having this I mean, okay, I'll write here A and B. Okay, there are two more neighbors of X on this tree. So A and B will be called children of X. Okay, so the other neighbors, of X in T, in the rooted tree, are called the children of this vertex X. Okay. So this is how the vertices are named. And then next, some other names are also there. Okay. vertices, having vertices, having the same parent are called siblings. Vertices having the same parent, are called siblings. So here, this X, and then you look some other, say these names I'll give, the name of these vertices, they are all siblings, okay? X, C, D. Here in this example, this X, C, D, they are all siblings. And here on this part, that we are looking at the vertices, okay, vertices on this path PX. This is what this red one is, this path, unique path PX. So Y is parent of X. What about the other vertices on this path? Say this is Z. Then the other vertices on this path are called ancestors of V. So here the parent is also sometimes considered as ancestor. So all the vertices in Px minus x, not x, are called the ancestors of the vertex x, of course including Px. Here we are including the parent also. Sometimes people, they do distinguish also if they require, are called the ancestors of X, this vertex. Fine. So these are some terminologies, and finally I'll just tell this about the height of a rooted tree. Height of a rooted tree is the length of a longest path from the root vertex. Okay. The height of a rooted tree, T is the length of a longest path from the root vertex. Longest path from the root vertex. The height of a rooted tree is the length of a longest path in T, in this T, from the root vertex. That is called height of a rooted tree. So here in this example, tell me, what is the height of the length of a longest path from the root vertex? Tell me, what is the height of this rooted tree? Can you answer? What is the height of this rooted tree?
I'm 5.
Yes. That longest path from the root vertex you are getting is here 5. Yes. So here it is equal to 5, height of this rooted tree. Okay. So this depending on the degree of this root vertex and other vertices, we also consider that binary tree. You might have heard also that binary tree, strictly binary tree. Okay. So binary trees, before I define this binary tree, why not we have this any k R E trees? Okay, any k R E trees. When k will be 2, we'll say binary tree. So here we consider that T be a rooted tree. Let T be a rooted tree. T be a rooted tree. If every vertex in T has every vertex in T has at most k children, okay, then the tree will be called a KRA tree. If every vertex of T has at most k children, has at most k children, k children, then T is called a KRA tree, called a KRA tree. Okay, K will be calling that will set K is a KRA tree. Okay, so K may be equal to 1 also, but that is not interesting one. That will be a path only. Okay, that will be a path. Well, at most k children. Okay, so some vertices will not be having any children also. For example, for leaf vertices they don't have any children. Okay, those pendant vertices or leaf vertices, they don't have any children. Okay, so that is called a KRA tree. So if we say that it is strictly KRA if every vertex except the leaf vertices will have exactly k number of children. Okay, so T is called strictly KRA. Here we are saying simply KRA. Is called strictly KRA. Strictly KRA. Strictly KRA tree is. Every non-leaf vertices, okay, every non-leaf vertex of T has exactly k children except the non-leaf vertices. Okay, every non-leaf vertex of T has exactly k children, then we say strictly KRA tree. Okay, and also another, just okay, I will go to next tree. And if it happens that in a strictly KRA tree, all the leaf vertices same label, then that is called complete KRA tree. Okay, so T is called complete KRA tree. Complete KRA tree is T is strictly KRA. strictly KRE tree, strictly KRE, and strictly KRE, and all the vertices are at the same level, and all the leaves are, all the leaves are the same level. Okay, all the same level. All the leaves are at same level. Well, so this is about, KRE tree, different kind of KRE tree. When k equal to 2, all these things are, called as binary. Okay, so if k equal to 2, then in the above definition, we use the word binary. Okay, then we can replace KRE by binary. Okay, then replace this word KRE by binary. Understand that everything will be, let's say, binary tree, strictly binary tree. Okay, so let me give one example now. Strictly binary tree. Let us give one example. Strictly binary tree means all the vertices except the leaf vertices have exactly 2 children. This is the root vertex. So here I may have like this. Okay. Or I may go like this. I may go like this. Okay. Every vertex other than this, other than every vertex, other than this leaf vertices have, okay, that they have exactly 2 children. Okay, this is our root vertex. This is a root vertex. So this is a strictly binary tree. Do we agree that this is a strictly binary tree? Every vertex other than the root vertex will have exactly 2 children. So this is a strictly, but this is example of a strictly binary tree. It is all right. So
yes,
this is but this is not a complete binary tree, right? Strictly binary tree, one example is this, but not complete binary tree. But not, why? But not complete binary. Not complete binary tree, right? Why? The leaf vertices are not at the same level. See, what is the level of this vertex? These leaves, actually, they are in which level? They are in level 2, second level. Level means the length of the path from that vertex to the root vertex. That is the level of that vertex. So here they are at level 2. Okay. And here you see, this is in level 3, this vortex, this leaf vortex, right? The length from of this path, yes, this is 3. So here they are level 4. They are at different levels, right? So the leaf vortices are at different levels. So therefore, this is not a complete binary tree. Okay, this is not a complete binary tree. Okay, let me give example. Okay, so let me give another example here. Say this tree here I have drawn. Okay, so this is my root vertex. I'll take this as my vertex. So I have taken this as my root vertex. So whether this is a binary tree? Whether this will be a binary tree. I have taken this as my root vertex. Tell whether this will be a binary tree. Yes or no? Quick. So whether this is a binary tree or not, my question is that the tree I have drawn here in this figure is a binary or not?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Yeah.
No, ma'am.
No,
ma'am.
No. Why? This root vortex is having three children, right?
Yes, ma'am. And one
reason.
Is.
Give me a root.
Yes, ma'am. And one of them is also doesn't have two children.
Not necessarily, at most two.
Okay.
At most two. Okay. Let us clear your doubt. Okay. See, I will write it. Fine. This is my root vortex. This is a binary tree. We are saying binary means at most two children. At most two children. Strictly binary means for every non-leaf vortices, exactly two. So here this root vortex is three children. So this we can say a three-aree tree. Understand? Three-aree tree. I mean every vortices have at the most three children. Okay. Three or less. 0, 1, 2, 3. This many number of children can have the vortices. So this is a three-aree tree. This is a binary tree. Understand? This one is strictly binary. Okay, this is every non-leaf vortices will have exactly two children. Every non-leaf, including the root vortex. So this is strictly binary. Okay, this is binary, this is three-aree. Because there is a vortex, the root vortex that has three children. Okay, this is three-aree. Now you got the thing? Okay. So here, I mean this you can easily prove that if you know the height of a K-aree tree, then the number of vortices. Okay, the number of vortices will have a you'll able to easily get this result. Okay, that you'll able to say that the number of vortices at the most, how many we can have. Okay, there, so let T be an N vortex K-aree tree. So K-aree tree of height H. Height is H, huh? Then height, you know that? The length of a longest path from the root vortex, that is the height. Then the number of vortices will be bounded by this h plus 1 less than or equal to n, and n will be at the most k to the power h plus 1 minus 1 divided by k minus 1. K is greater than or equal to 2, huh? K R E tree. Here, K R E tree. K is greater than or equal to 2. Otherwise, this will not make sense. This K minus 1, leave it K equal to 1. Okay, fine. So, this number of vortices will be bounded like this. Hope we'll able to prove. This is a very easy one. Can you? Proof is left as an exercise for you. That you'll able to prove. This I leave as exercise to you. Okay. However, if this tree is a complete K-aree tree, we get an immediate corollary. Tree is complete K-aree tree. Is complete K-aree tree, then this n, that will, the total number that this right hand side will be equality. That, value of n will be equal to k to the power h plus 1 minus 1 divided by k minus 1. This right hand side equality you'll get if it is a complete K-aree tree. So in that case, you'll easily able to count actually, because all the leaf vortices have the same label. That h, label will be h. Height is h. Height is equal to h means all the leaf vortices will label h. And all the non-leaf vortices will have exactly k children. So for the, root vortex, root vortex will have degree, root vortex will have degree k. And all other vortices other than leaf vortices, other than root vortex, they will have degree k plus 1. Okay, complete KRE. Okay, so here in this, complete KRE. Okay, just I'll give one example of a complete KRE tree. Okay, so just quickly we'll see. I'll draw a complete 3RE tree, say. Or complete binary will. Okay, complete binary, suppose I'll draw. Okay, complete binary. So root vortex. Complete binary tree. Okay. See here, all the leaf vortices have to be in the same level. Okay, this is one example of a complete binary tree. This is my root vortex. This is my root vortex. So all the leaf vortices, they are at level 3. Okay, so this is one example of a complete binary tree. Complete binary tree. You check whether the number of complete binary tree of height 3. Complete binary tree with this height 3. With this height is equal to 3. Okay. So you make, find out this number of vortices in this formula. So similarly, this complete, the 3RE tree, the complete 3RE tree, one example I could have given 3 children. Every, non-leaf vortices will have 3 children. So this is complete 3RE tree of height 2. Okay. So here, this complete 3RE tree with h is equal to 2, height 2. Right. Okay, then that's all for today. I'll stop here. If you have any query, any doubt, then you can ask me. Okay, students. If you have any doubt, any query, then you can ask.